You know, humanity has quite the collection of great mysteries. The Zodiac Killer, Stonehenge, the director of Mean Girls having directed Vampire Academy, also the writer of Heathers having written Vampire Academy. They're brothers, by the way.
You guys are brothers, correct?
That's what the hospital says.
The rest of their filmography doesn't add up either. They were involved in a lot of good stuff back in the day, then Vampire Academy hit them and it's all downhill from there. I don't know what to make of these two. Do they happen to do well when working with other more talented individuals, or are they just inconsistently genius? I'm similarly confused by the cast, because when I watched this movie the first time, I thought half the reason I hated it was bad acting, but I've since liked a couple of the actors in other things. Zoe Dutch has been popping up everywhere recently, and I think she's swell. I just found out her and Haley Lee Richardson aren't the same person, but that's beside the point. My boy Ian Gallagher is in it. I haven't seen Modern Family, but I like Sarah Hyland because she's dating Wells from The Bachelor, and they're really cute. I guess that still leaves a whole lot of cast to dislike, but I really don't think any of them are incompetent. Maybe this girl, but not the rest of them. So how did this big crew of proven non-incompetent people come together and whip up the worst vampire movie ever? It doesn't add up. I'm not sure why Twilight has to be the subject of mass cultural hatred while this is on the table, and so I must explain to you why I dislike it on Halloween, because vampires. I really did intend to make more than one Halloween video this year. I wanted to talk about some horror movies for once, but I didn't, and now we're here now. So, Vampire Academy was a book series first, as everything is, and it seems like the studio anticipated that it would be successful enough to warrant a franchise. However, as you might be able to guess, as there is only one movie, that did not happen. It grossed only half of its budget, and less than even other flops of the supernatural YA subgenre. Ticket sales were so low, they straight up canceled the theatrical releases in the UK and Brazil. It bombed, like, bad. Not just in profit, but in reception. Critics hated the movie, as did its built-in fanbase. There were some people that liked it, but not enough that the Indiegogo campaign for a sequel would be successful. I mean, not nearly enough. It has its defenders, but by and by it seems the fans of the book aren't big on the movie. I considered reading it for this review, but checking out some blog posts and articles has led me to believe it wasn't the specifics of the plot being fiddled with that really bothered readers, but the complete and total tonal shift. I guess the book is more emotional and brooding, but the studio wanted it so badly not to be Twilight that they leaned into the teen drama comedy side of things, hence hiring the Waters brothers.
I think it was important not to go crazy with all the vampire and gothic stuff and, like, keep it grounded in just another day in high school.
If anything, we thought let's make a high school movie first, and then be able to, you know, make it more exciting by having the fact that you could get killed after lunch period because you were dealing with vampires.
I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, book fans, because I've only read the sample, but I think just in the first couple pages, it's obvious how much less serious and more teeny bopper they went with things. Like, the opening, for instance, is mainly the same aside from dialogue, but boy does the dialogue do a quick 180 from mysterious to exposition dumping sass.
It wasn't a dream.
I know. The accident.
You being in my head, it's so weird.
You should know by now, with us, weird doesn't begin to cover it. Why do you have a scary poster of an American ex-president?
It's been less than a year since we ran away from the Academy. 2 years since the crash. Do you really think the Academy's still trying to hunt us down?
I think we may have to get plastic surgery.
No, don't. Please.
Yeah?
It seems to have the Mean Girls 2, Legally Blondes, Bring It On Worldwide cheer smack curse of dumbing young adult material down to the point it could be aired on Nick at Night. You'll notice that this PG-13 vampire movie avoids swear words.
I took it upon myself to talk to these royal pains in the butt.
It also turned a dramatic romance novel into a rom-com horror sort of monstrosity. I'm realizing that this is the sort of thing that happens when creative properties are left in the hands of people who don't respect them. Like, this movie is constantly poking fun at the supernatural teenage romance craze of the early 2010s.
And they don't sparkle either. Now for the obligatory cafeteria scene. Sort of. Ever wonder what happened to that friend of yours obsessed with vampire books and shows?
She writes Twilight fanfiction.
Have you read any of it?
God, no.
This might all be an attempt at self-awareness, but in my mind, self-awareness in film relies on embracing the genre or trope you're tackling as opposed to resenting it. This movie wants to distance itself from the less cool, very girly Teen Wolf's Vampire Diaries and Twilights of the world, despite being that. It tries so hard to be self-aware that it's the opposite. Hey, Vampire Academy, Do you know what you are? Your vampire academy, okay? Take a step off that high horse, would ya? I think that if they had just stayed true to the tone of the book, it could have gone over well. I mean, among critics, this book series is considered to be better than a lot of its counterparts. Anyway, I'm getting like so far ahead of myself. Vampire Academy is about Rose and Alyssa. These are them. Alyssa's whole family died in a car accident listening to MIA. That opening actually does give you a pretty good idea of how quick this movie will just switch tones on you. Live fast, die young, bad girls do it well. Car crash. Okay, sorry. Anyway, they live in a secret vampire society in which Lyssa is a princess Moroi and Rose is a dampier tasked with protecting her. No matter how many times they said those words in the movie, I never got a grip on them. I don't know how to say them. There's also a third type of vampire called the Strigoi. I could get into what all of that means, but the movie spells it out unceremoniously enough that I can just show you.
My best friend Lyssa Dragomir is a royal member of a magical ancient race, the Moroi. But yes, like most creatures with fangs, the Moroi live off blood. But they don't live forever. And like these other guys, I'm a Dampier. We are the protectors, the guardians. Dampier lives are dedicated to protecting the Moroi. We live by one simple expression, they come first. And then there's group number three, the bad vampires, the Strigoi. Evil bloodsuckers that only come out at night and can only be killed by a silver stake. If you're lucky, they'll just rip you apart. But they can also turn you into one of them.
Basically, the first 20 minutes of this thing is narration designed to help us understand the mythology, which is already made understandable by the heavy-handed expositional dialogue.
What's that, not Strigoi?
No, not Strigoi, thank God. Guardians.
Okay.
So you're taking us back to the academy. You know, I kept the princess safe and hidden for an entire year before you got lucky. Wow, it's a lot of Malnia marks you got there.
You've killed 6 Strigoi. We were afraid that we'd run into one of them back there.
If you had drawn interest to Strigoi, we wouldn't be having this conversation.
Vasilisa Dragomir is from one of the 12 royal families.
She's the last of the Dragomir line.
He could have just used one spoon-feeding tactic. I didn't need them all. Because of this, though, the plot doesn't really kick off for a while. Basically, Lyssa and Rose ran away from the Vampire Academy for reasons, and now they've been caught by Rose's love interest and are back. Some things have changed, however, like Lyssa's ex-boyfriend has snagged himself a new, very reasonable and realistically mannered girlfriend.
But deep down, she's sweet.
Back off, bitch. He's mine now.
How does it feel to leave at the top and come back at the bottom? Don't like what I'm saying? What are you gonna do about it?
She will spend the rest of the movie being a minor nuisance with no real stake in the larger story. Meanwhile, Rose finds that missing a year of training has made her weaker than Ian Gallagher, who is her best Dampier friend. He also has a crush on her, because of course he has a crush on her. You'll find that a lot of this story is reliant on background information, which was maybe easier to convey in the book, but mostly annoying here. It feels like stepping into a TV show that's already been going on for a couple of seasons, but instead of asking whoever you're watching with to explain it to you, the main character won't shut up about what's happened. We're not even fully caught up yet, because we have a bunch more characters to meet. Next is that guy from Shadowhunters, whose name is Christian in this. His parents are evil, and so people think he's evil. And what do you know? He's Lyssa's love interest. The second they meet, it's super weird, blunt, and somehow still boring.
Don't worry. I don't bite. Well, only literally.
What are you doing here?
This is where I come to get away.
Hey, this was my special place before it was your special place.
What do you have to get away from, princess? What do you know about pain? Break a nail off in your tiara?
Excuse me, after a car crash—
You got off easy. When your folks died, there was a pretty funeral, and everybody cried. When my mother and father were hunted down, everybody cheered. I hate what they chose to become. But they were still my parents. What was it like outside the academy?
It was kind of scary. Just the two of us out there, but it's also kind of great.
It's also noteworthy that Rose is watching this interaction take place through her telepathic best friend bond thing with Lyssa that exists, by the way, and she talks out loud in second person as if Lyssa can hear her.
You know you're talking to Christian Azera, right? Parents transform themselves into Strigoi. Get away from that freak!
You say anything, girl, people will get the wrong idea.
But later it's revealed that she can't.
Not Christian Azera's.
Who told you?
I was sorta, you know, there.
So I guess this was just Rose's personal commentary on the matter. It's not the last time she'll do that either.
You did not just flip your hair back. That's your move. She's flirting, folks.
Immediately after that, we are treated to a scene of Rose and her love interest, Dimitri, who's like a higher level vampire than her. He's also way older than her. I don't know how old the characters are supposed to be, but she was 20 and he was 30 when they filmed this, which makes me, a 20-year-old, very uncomfortable. Even though, I mean, it's commonplace. I actually think she's supposed to be a minor in the story and he's supposed to be like still 30 in the story, so I don't know. It's gross. I'm not a fan, to be honest. Age aside, I'm still made uncomfortable by their relationship because this man reminds me a lot of Tommy Wiseau.
What a story, Mark.
I think it's the hair and the accent, which feels rude to say because this guy is Russian, like just a regular old Russian with a regular Russian accent, and Tommy Wiseau has like a famously ambiguous accent.
I did not hit her. It's not true. It's bullshit. I did not hit her. I did not.
But I can't escape this. I don't know. I'm sorry, Dimitri. There's also Sarah Hyland, who plays talkative nerd girl.
Princess Vasilisa. I mean, Lisa, you said I could call you Lisa, but if I can't anymore, this is totally fine.
Lena.
Solo St. Vlad, so much has happened. Well, nothing bigger than your escape, of course. Why did you?
I think adaptations are consistently bad at portraying nervous talkers from books. There's something inherently juvenile and Disney Channel-esque about rapid-fire, quirky girl dialogue. Anyway, she's the daughter of this sick man who is some sort of authority figure at the academy. The two of them are important later. Then, nearly half an hour into the movie, we are introduced to Jesse, who is a hot guy with whom Rose has a flirtationship. He'll attempt to sexually assault her here in a minute and then lie about the encounter to the whole school.
Me and my boy Jesse and that damn tramp last night.
What?
Truth hurts, blood whore.
That's basically his only function in the narrative. Finally, I think we know all the background and the actual story can happen. The story that is convoluted, to say the least. It's a big Frankenstein's monster of plot lines, tones, and characters. I don't know how closely the movie follows the book, but my assumption is that it would have been more effectively adapted into a TV show. There's just a lot going on, and it happens very fast. There's this teenage drama stuff about pixie cut revealing that Lissa drank Rose's blood on the run, which is apparently really taboo.
Rose, I bleed for you.
No, it's Rose who does the bleeding.
And not just hooking up, fanging up, they claim they
absolutely no. Well, actually, Jesse and I did make out a little.
You guys were doing it. I'm not surprised Rose got addicted, Nick, with Jesse.
She didn't do it with Jesse.
And it damages their reputation, so Lissa starts compelling people to be her friend to become the most popular girl in school again, but gets over that phase pretty quickly and renders the arc meaningless. Rose convinces Christian that Lissa doesn't like him, but she does, and it's all quite melodramatic for a couple that's not really dating and has just kind of hung out in the library a couple times.
Seriously, Christian, go away. It's what Lissa wants.
You don't have to pretend anymore. You've had your little flirtation with the dark side.
What her abilities
are. You sabotaged the first good thing to happen to me in a long time. And now you want me to help you.
Rose has a crush on Dimitri, but they can't date because he's an elderly man.
It's one thing if I were 36 and you were 28. Or even me 28 and you 20.
Your life is about homework, dances, parties.
Meanwhile, Ian is upset that she doesn't like him and jealous that she made out with Jesse, and you can't help but wonder if that's the sort of thing the story could have done without, because it never really amounts to anything but the unrequited love it started as. Then again, maybe the sequels to the book have more to do with Ian, and they couldn't lessen his role here without tarnishing potential movie sequels. The world may never know, unless you've read the books, in which case you might know. The main thing is a mystery about who's threatening Lissa via blood messages on walls and dead cats hanging from doorways. Some of this stuff was done by pixie cut in a ritual threesome with Jesse and this other guy. Really, seriously, actually.
We thought it'd be fun to all hook up in the princess's room and things got out of hand. Literally. It's called blood splash. It's a new Moroi fad where when things get hot and sticky, you fang open your wrist and spray.
Ew!
But the rest was done by the real villain of the thing. They find out that that is Sarah Hyland's sickly father after having a good time at the school dance. You see how this is all a lot? I mean, sloppily bullet-pointing the plot points to you might be making it sound worse than it is, but I swear, the film isn't consistent at all with how many arcs and genres it's trying to balance. Anyways, sickly old man wants Lissa to die in order to heal him of his sickliness, but some action happens and she's saved. Then it's revealed that Sarah Hyland was also in on it the whole time. Some more action happens and Rose is saved. Cheesy speech and roll credits.
Blood. Blood is what connects us all. No more bad blood.
I know that I've summarized this movie to you in a much sloppier manner than I would usually, but that's because I don't dislike the movie's plot all that much. I can't think of any major plot holes or unclear themes. Most of what's set up comes back. It's structurally sound, probably because it's working from the book. It's the general atmosphere of the thing I don't like. The disrespect to its own demographic, the inconsistent tone, the mind-numbingly silly dialogue.
Let's make tonight our bitch.
Why are you dragging me? You're such drag!
Sweet sassy molassy.
Hells yes.
It's just not very good in almost every aspect besides plot. I'm tempted to read the book for that reason, but 6 books is a big time commitment for someone who can't stop reading a series until it's over. Anyway, I guess that's all I have to say. Happy Halloween, folks.